have you here. Praise God. The Lord is in his house. Of course, he never isn't anywhere. He's always with us. But it sure is nice, Lord, to be able to be together with you. Lord, we ask that you come and fill us with your Holy Spirit. Fill us as we watch online. And we pray that prayer that you prayed that said we would be one with you, and just as you are one with the Father, because of your Spirit in us. So we ask for that unity, Lord. And we thank you, Lord. Touch each one of us and let us hear your voice and know your presence. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Some of you here today, some of you online, have burdens, have concerns about your health, about your finances, about your family. Will you take this time to surrender all of that to your precious Lord? He says, "Give it to me. I'll take care of it." Surrender it all to me.
Change today, because we've all gone through an amazing, maybe odd change in our lives this week. And I'm speaking to the children, so you can act like a child or think like a child while I do this. But this has been a weird time, and we are changing because that's what we're told to do. So what are some of the ways we have to change? This is one of them. We have to cover up our mouth and nose because we don't want to spread germs during the epidemic. We have to sit far apart because unless we're with family, because we don't want anything that somebody else has. We don't want it. And so, what else? What else do we do when we're different? Raise your hands. We should have been doing that all along, but yes, we wash our hands, we use more Purell. I have it all written down and it's in my chair. So I think I'll end already and say that God never changes. Thank God that he doesn't. Thank you that you don't. We have an incredible God, and he's always the same no matter when. Yesterday, today, always he is the same, and we can count on him, we can love him, we can praise him because he is solid and he is with us. Thank you, Jesus, for this time. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I did have my notes.
Good morning and welcome, church family, those here in the sanctuary and those in your sanctuaries at home. I want to that the flowers on the altar from Don Bellows in memory for the glory of the Lord, and also in memory of his wife Edie. Announcements. For our announcements today, want to call your attention this evening. 6 o'clock is our healing service, and Daria Rosenberg will be speaking and on the gift. Second announcement today is new hours for the healing rooms. You are able to come in person to the healing rooms, and they're open from 5 to 6:30. If you're unable to come and want to do it online via Zoom, then drop them an email at ccf.healingrooms@gmail.com, and they'll arrange a time for you. New Sunday school class next Sunday morning, 9 o'clock, in the fireside room. Daria Rosenberg is going to start a 5-week study titled The 3-Mile Walk. And it's a little more description. Awaken to the call, the courage to live the life that God wants for you. So it sounds like an interesting, good Bible study next Sunday morning. The last announcement I have, or just a reminder, and also a thank you. Thank you for all you who are getting your offerings into the church, whether it's by snail mail, whether you're dropping it by the church, or whether you're doing it by credit card. But I've also got some good news for you today. We're also able to give your offering as you come to the sanctuary. So you have an option now, a fourth option, to come and join us in the sanctuary and give there. So thank you for this time, Lord, and I'll introduce the offering. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this, your church. We thank you for all those who are giving, Lord, to support the ministry of this church. Thank you for what you're doing here, Lord. And we just lift these offerings to you, that we would use them wisely, that we would use them in your service, Lord. So thank you. Thank you for this time we share together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Place
some place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. With all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all you, I'm in all. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" What boat do you need to come out of? Is it a boat of comfort? Is it a coat of doubt? Jesus calls you to come. I want you to close your eyes now and let Jola sing our prayer to the Lord.
You in the ministry.
us such glorious, glorious truth that we belong to you. Lord, we want to know that truth even more fully in this moment. We want to leap out of the boat. As timid as we feel in our heart, we want to be like Peter and come to you. And we're aware, Lord, of how much our world needs your grace, your love, your truth, and how much you've deposited in us that we have to share. Lord, help us to be bold. Help us to step out. Help us to hear your voice. Help us to go past the barriers that society would put up around us. Help us to reach out past our own fear, past our own doubt, past our own insecurity or sense of inadequacy, and see you there waiting. See you there calling. See you there carrying us forward, so that as we offer this love that you gave us, it'll be a love of transformation, reconciliation, restoration. As we reach out, Lord, help that reaching out be met by other hearts who have been made ready by your presence and your grace already at work in them. Help us to be responsive in such a way that the people see something different in us and want to know why we walk in a peace or a hope, or better yet, a love that is different than what is out in our world this day. We know that you know. We know that you know all about us. We know that you know all about our culture, all about our world, and all the ways we, your children, have decided to be at odds with each other. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us for the ways that we shrink back. Forgive us for the ways that we hold in to our group, our security, our rules, our safety. You told us we were supposed to come and share your love to the ends of everyone. We ask for your forgiveness for thinking that we can be selective about who we share you with. None of us, Lord, we know, none of us would be here had somebody not stepped out and offered you to us or to our family line or to something in our past. We know we don't have the privilege of sitting by the sidelines or in the safety of the boat. Call us out, Lord, with a boldness of faith and a boldness of love that changes the world around us. It's what you did. You gave yourself in love. And because of that love, our world is forever different, and we thank you for it. And you call us into unity with you to be on that mission. And so we say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And as your people, as your children, we are bold to approach you as our loving Heavenly Father, our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power. power, and the glory forever. Our first lesson is from the prophet Joel. It speaks of the time after the scary day of the Lord, when locusts had come and devoured everything, and it even describes armies coming and overrunning Israel. And it's looking to a time past the exile, a time still to come. It's this passage that Peter quotes when he first talks about the Holy Spirit's coming at Pentecost. Let's hear from Joel, and then we'll hear what Peter does once that Spirit takes hold of him in our reading from Acts. Brother Wayne.
The reading from Joel 2. For the years the locusts have eaten, the great locust and the young locust, the other locusts and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be shamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. And afterward I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old man will dream dreams. Your young man will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance. As the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Now the reading from Acts 10. At Caesarea there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day, about 3 p.m, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God who came to him and said, "Cornelius." Cornelius stared at him in fear. "What is it, Lord?" he asked. The angel answered, "Your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa, Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea." When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devout soldier who was. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat, and while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I have never eaten anything unpure or unclean." The voice said, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened 3 times, and immediately the sheep was taken back to heaven. While Peter was wondering about the meaning of the vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Simon, 3 men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them." Peter went down and said to the men, "I am the one you were looking for. Why have you come?" The men replied, "We have come from Cornelius the centurion. He is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to ask you to come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say." Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. The next day, Peter started out with them, and some of the believers from Joppa went along. The following day, he arrived at Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet. But Peter made him get up. "Stand up," he said. "I am only a man myself." While talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. He said to them, "You are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with or visit a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me?" Cornelius answered, "3 days ago I was in my house praying at this hour, at 3 in the afternoon. Suddenly a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, 'Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest in the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. So I sent for you immediately, and it was good for you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us.' Then Peter began to speak. 'I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead on the 3rd day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles, for they had heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Surely no one can stand in the way of their being baptized with water. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So we ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ." Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. This is God's word for the people of God.
Thank you, Wayne. $2 bits, $4 bits, $6 bits, $1. All four. Insert the name of your school. Stand up and holler. Go Baylor. Just had to get that on my system. I can't imagine what you must think. Why is he excited? Football. Woo! Football's back. We're not stuck. There are some places where people have broken out. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, that has nothing to do with today's sermon. But we're going to be talking about visions, dreams, barriers being crossed, new understanding coming our way, and the leadership of the Holy Spirit. So Lord, we just ask that by your Spirit, you come and guide each of our thoughts. I want whatever comes out of my mouth to only be what you want shared. We can talk about that cheer in a minute, but even that, everything, Lord, is for you. And let that be true for us. And wherever we are in our journey, Lord, we would ask that you would pull us closer to you and make us ready to be the emissaries that you call us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. So if I say the number 103, does that mean anything? Come on. 103 days till Christmas. Are you excited? Are you ready? Skip Halloween, skip the election, skip Thanksgiving. Let's get on with Christmas. I had a dream about Christmas this morning. I was in college. Strange. I wonder where that came from, having spent the day watching football in the few minutes I had free yesterday. And there was somebody driving up with this great big truckload of pizza. Like hundreds of pizzas. And there was Christmas decorations already up. And there was this tradition where the dean of the school had to go find some ornaments that had been hidden. And I was given the task of hiding the ornaments. So I'm in my dorm room hiding the ornaments. The dean's scouring the school, shows up in my room, and the ornaments are right there on the desk, plain as day, and the dean ignores them. What? I want that pizza. I want Christmas. Let's go. And I wake up. If somebody has an interpretation of the dream, let me know. Because I don't actually feel like that one is going to change my world. But today's story, where Peter and Cornelius both have an encounter with the Lord that's in that category of dream and vision, changed us, changed the world. And we are the benefactors even to this day. I'm going to go back a little bit in our timeline. So today's sermon title includes Living Our New Normal, Loved, Love, and Loving, with the focus being on the loving today. But we get here with our emphasis on Peter after the last 2 weeks. So just a quick summary of the last 2 weeks. Peter, in the Garden of Gethsemane, tells Jesus, oh, I'm going to be with you. Hold, I can handle it. Yeah, I've learned my lesson since I was on the boat and I started to sink. I know what it means is to trust you now. I can do it. Peter, Jesus says, tonight before the rooster crows 3 times, you're going to deny me. Oh, Lord, never, never, never. I'd fight for you. I'd die for you. I'd go to prison for you. A few minutes later, hours or so later, they're in that courtyard of the high priest. Peter's accent has given him away. People know he's from Galilee instead of southern Israel. Surely you must be one of him. I don't know that guy. I've never met the man. I'm not one of them. And he makes eye contact with Jesus. And we know that Jesus knew that moment was coming. As much as Peter's filled with grief and shame, he knows that Jesus knows his failure, his betrayal, his abandonment, and he's heartbroken. But Jesus knew that about Peter, just like Jesus knows that about us. No matter where we are, what's happened, no matter what we've done that has let him down, he loves us anyway, went to the cross for us anyway, went to the cross, went to the tomb, came out of the tomb so that we would know that he loves us. The Father sent him so that we, I might add, and they would know that God loves us. Peter bumps into the risen Lord. That might have been a little bit of a shake your world kind of moment. He's still not sure what to do. Week later, a few days after that, he's up in Galilee fishing with his buddies, trying to figure out what this all means. Jesus meets him on the beach and says, after they've had some food together, Peter, let's take a walk. You know the story we talked about last week. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Why is he asking me this? Yes, Lord, I love you. Tend to my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know everything about me. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep. It says Peter was distressed that he got asked that question the third time. But Jesus was leading Peter into the truth of who he was as a disciple, as an expression of God's image, as a man devoted to God, an identity created by God before Peter was ever born, imagined by God before anyone ever thought Peter would be here, an identity of love, an identity filled with the redemption of the cross and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit in love. At this point, Peter does not yet have the indwelling Holy Spirit, but he's on his way to understanding what this new truth means about being loved. Pentecost comes. The disciples are still basically afraid. They're getting a little bit more willing to at least gather together. But, you know, if they kill Jesus, they're going to kill us if they get their chance. They're in the upper room. And our prophecy from Joel takes over. All of the wind, like a freight train to us, or a hurricane, or a tornado, just... And people are so disturbed by the sound, they come running. And the people in that upper room, they see what looks like tongues of fire on each other. And they all burst out boldly into the streets. There's a million people in Jerusalem during this festival. These 100 maybe or so come bursting out and start declaring God's love for all. They come and they wonder what's happening. They can't believe the fact that they all understand in their native tongue that this declaration of love is happening. What could this be? They think they might be drunk, but how can they be drunk and speaking in my... Oh, that doesn't make sense. Peter stands up. Timid, shy, scared Peter stands up and says, "Men of Israel, it's not what you think." And he declares the truth of what Jesus had done and what that gift meant for them and what could happen if they received that truth. And they say, "What must we do to be saved?" And 3,000 the first day, a couple more thousand a little bit later. And now Peter's been walking pretty boldly in this faith. He's healed some people. He's on a trip out from Jerusalem. By the time we come to this reading in Acts 10, he's out from Jerusalem, out in Joppa, chapter 9, which just means like the day or so before. He's healed a couple people, including raising one young woman from the dead. I'd say by this point, the Holy Spirit has got a hold of him. He's willing to pay attention. It's about lunchtime, and he's up on the top of the house where he's staying, and he has a vision that makes him rethink. As far as he's come with the Lord, and as far as he's come as a son of Israel, he has to rethink who he is and what his purpose is and how he fits into the world. The vision comes. He sees this sheet-like thing coming down, and it's filled with animals. Kill and eat. He is a good Jewish boy, and he would not defile himself by eating those animals. It's against the law. It says so in Leviticus, chapter 11 or so. You can't eat. Well, I don't know what he saw, but there's a lot of things that you're not supposed to eat in this ceremonial rule. Happens again. No, I don't. Happens again. And then the Lord explains the vision. If I have declared it clean, how can you mark it as unclean? Peter's thinking. What does this mean? You know, I imagine in that time of reflection, he's remembering some of the things he heard Jesus talk about. There was one time the Pharisees were looking at Jesus and his disciples, and they were all bent out of shape because the disciples had the audacity to eat without having washed their hands in a ceremonial way before. And Jesus said to them, "You hypocrites, you pile on rules that are human traditions, and as a result of those rules, you divide people from the God who loves them." He even gives the example, you would let somebody's parents starve because you would say to your daughter, "No, you can't give that to them because you dedicated to the Lord." That's the Lord's now. Don't do that. Jesus talks about this new understanding. He reminds them of things like the prophet Isaiah had said, when it says, "My servant, whom I love, will come, and all the nations will start to come to Mount Zion and begin to know that I am God." Or Isaiah, I think it's 49, "It's not enough for me to bring back just Israel and Judah from captivity. I want all nations to come unto me." Or maybe even thought about what he said about Abraham, reminding them that, remember, Abraham's hope and promise was that by him all nations would be blessed. This message of love, Jesus has opened to all. Prior to this vision, Peter had thoughts about this, but had not yet moved into the truth of this. So he's sitting there thinking about this vision. Why would you show me? Okay, I get the message. I'm going to pay attention to the vision. I'm going to pay attention to the dream. I'll let you lead me, Holy Spirit. Why? Knock, knock, knock. Don't be afraid to go with those men who are knocking at the door. Don't be hesitant. Okay, those men, what's up? other scene. You know, the Holy Spirit doesn't just sit here in the front pew and wait for us, and if we take time to come over and talk to him, there he is. He's actually active. He was active before you woke up, getting you ready. He was active before you tuned in. He has been working on this guy named Cornelius. Cornelius has watched the people of God. He's out there in Caesarea, which is about 70 miles from Jerusalem. It's a Roman city. Well, Herod did a lot of stuff to try to bolster his ego there. So it's got all these amazing things, many of which are still there to this day. You can go see the aqueduct, you can go see the amphitheater. Herod did those things to make himself live up to his name, Herod the Great. Cornelius is there. He's a centurion. He is the captain, the colonel of 100 men, Roman, Gentile. Yet he has, in his heart, there's been a stirring that gets him to want to give to the poor, pay attention to things of God. He's on the outside looking in. There's no way he'd ever make it inside the temple. He'd be lucky to even be in Jerusalem during a festival and sort of stand somewhere out there in the parking lot and watch all the rest of the folks. But he has a vision. An angel comes to him, says, "Come, listen, the Lord has seen you." The Lord sees us. Like he saw Peter in the garden, he sees Cornelius. He sees us. There isn't anything in our life that he doesn't see. Cornelius is seen by the Lord, and the Lord has purpose for him. Send for Peter. It's 2 days' journey, about 30 miles to Joppa. Send for him. Cornelius calls his servants, one of his attendants, and who's already paying attention to God as well, send for Peter. Takes him 2 days to get there. They're knocking at the door now. Peter says, "I'm the one you're seeking. What is it? Our master would like you to come with us." Peter says, "Yes." 2 days back, you know, Cornelius now has had about 4 days to get ready. What's he do? He can't wait to hear what this man of God, the angel said, go listen to, has to say. So he calls his family, he calls his friends. There's a whole, the word in the Greek is a congregation there waiting at his house when Peter shows up. 2 days of travel, Peter shows up. And the first thing he has to do is say, well, moment of truth, do I cross this threshold or do I stay back? I am not supposed to talk to people like you. It makes me dirty as a Jew to come into your house. I'm a very righteous Jew. I can't do this. Well, Lord, that vision, maybe this is the kind of thing that you were talking about. So he walks in, violating all the traditions that he had grown up obeying. And he even says that first thing. I, a Jew, am not supposed to be here, but the Lord has shown me that I was to come. What is it that you want? And I just love it. They want to hear what he has to share. They don't know yet. They know that God has something for them, but they don't know what it is. So Peter tells them about this man, Jesus, who was the Son of God, who came and gave himself that all who would believe on his name might be saved. He's going on, he's talking. I don't know if he remembers the Pentecost day with people reacting where 3,000 came and said, we want to be saved as well. But all of a sudden, the whole group, dozens at the minimum, are speaking in tongues. He perceives and knows that the Holy Spirit has come. Was already there, mind you. But he recognizes the Holy Spirit is there and on them. Okay, Lord, this is it. This must be what you meant when you said the love of God, the message would start in Jerusalem, go to Judea and Samaria, and then to the ends of the earth. Well, it can't go to the ends of the earth unless it breaks out of the role of only being a parochial mindset. And they're baptized with water. That's not the end of the story. It's the end of the lesson. But we hear the same story told three more times in the book of Acts. Gee, I wonder if we should pay attention to it. One time, two times. There's this, what's that saying? If it's repeated in the Bible, it probably means it's important. Okay, so we hear this story three times. Peter actually gets called on the carpet by the other Jewish Christians. Why would you do this? He has to defend himself. He has to describe what the Lord had done and what this means. And they come up with some guidelines about what to do with non-Jewish believers. But this is the start of taking the gospel and its hope to the whole world. Starts here. And it continues. Paul picks it up and goes throughout the Mediterranean. And I thank God that this is true. None of us, I don't see any Middle Eastern Jews among us, none of us would be here if it weren't for the change of how this message was to spread. I have to ask my son's forgiveness because I'm honoring Kansas City and I was rooting for them against the Titans of Houston Thursday night. Sorry, Sam, I know you're a Houston Titan fan, but somewhere along the line, I just sort of, well, it's mainly because Patrick Mahomes, quarterback of the Kansas City Chiefs, used to be a Big 12 player, college, you know, okay. This cup was given to me by a friend, George. George went searching. 1 week, this is 6 or 8 months ago, he found our number. I don't know if he contacted me first by email or by phone, probably email. But he found our healing rooms. I think he was doing his search somewhere in Orange County. He put in enough words that he found that we, Clairemont Christian Fellowship, all 110 members of us in this little bitty neighborhood of Clairemont in San Diego had healing rooms. That's what he felt God calling him to seek out. And the first he made it, he came in, asked for prayer. We had prayed in preparation for his arrival and we shared what the Lord had given us. I don't actually I said, that's not my job in there. I'm supposed to hear from the Lord and share. He still remembers what he heard from the Lord in that encounter. And it gave him hope to endure what he was up against. He was having to move to Tijuana where he could afford to be because there were some business things happening that weren't treating him fairly. The coronavirus hit and his family was afraid to have him nearby. And he's living in Tijuana by himself. Then we saw on the news the kneeling on George Floyd's neck. We started having some struggles in the conflict of what's fair. How do we deal with what's not fair, and how do we articulate love and justice. We had been praying with each other. We had known each other as brothers in the Lord. And then he sent me a text. Two pictures. One side, the officer kneeling on George Floyd's neck. The other side, Colin Kaepernick kneeling. And he asked me the question, "Now, do you understand?" I had to think, "Lord, what am I going to say in this situation? Do I skirt the issue, stay superficial, let him stay in the category of just someone I know as a casual associate? Surprise, surprise, that wasn't the So we engaged the conversation. And we got cultural mandates of it's either this way or that way. I'm either right and you're wrong, or you're right and I'm wrong. And our relationship deepened. And it's not just because we both are cheering for the Chiefs. He grew up in Kansas City. As he got ready to move to Boston, and he's probably watching now. Bless you, brother. We are together. And we have to be together. There is no luxury in the family of God to stay back and get comfortable, staying in the boat, getting with just the people who think like I do, look like I do, act like I do. We have to get up and go. My experience is not his experience. Courage back into the United States. He's my age. We've lived the same number of years, but he wondered if he'd be safe. It doesn't do any good for me to try to tell him, "Oh, that's a figment of your imagination. You don't have to be afraid." When the Lord speaks to us being right is not his priority. Our human traditions, just like their human traditions that said your disciples are being unclean because their hands haven't been washed correctly, the Lord breaks all those human barriers that we so skillfully put up between us. We're in a time right now where the color of our skin means that we should be choosing sides. And then that gets translated to the color of our politics. And that gets translated into, well, we can't even have a conversation, because if we do, we're going to hate each other. Perfect love drives out fear. Hate is... We people need to let this love that we have known... If you are perfect and have ever been perfect, raise your hand, stand up and cheer. We want to see what you look like. We have been known by a Lord that doesn't stop because of our iniquity, of our brokenness, of our woundedness. He comes to us knowing everything about us and says, "You are mine and you are precious to me." In fact, that is in, people of God. I want you living, knowing that I love you, and knowing that you actually love me. That's the first and most important thing in your life, loving me. If you get those two, you'll be ready to love in my name. You'll be ready. And it's not going to be based on legislation or winning a debate or fill in the blank. It's going to be based on us letting the truth of God's love lead us through the Holy Spirit in each and every encounter. Peter got up from his rest. He knew the Lord said, don't hesitate to go. It's going to feel like the rules would say don't go, but I need you to go. Lord, I ask that you, not me, not my words, not my ideas, but you speak to each one of us, because each one of us sits in a strategic place for you. Peter didn't necessarily know Joppa was strategic or that rooftop was strategic, but you had him close enough that he could get to Cornelius at Caesarea. You have us close enough so that we can get across the street. We can get down the block. We can get across that barrier that's in front of us that says, don't come near. Lord, make us bold. Make us willing to let this love that we have grow and grow and grow and spill out in a stingy way, but in an overflowing way. We are yours, Lord. We are. But we also know that you want the ones that we call they just as fervently as you want us. So help us, Lord. In Jesus' name.
This is my daily bread.
It's not a grandchild, but that's me and my brother George. Lord, you have made us one with yourself. You have made us one with each other. And you call us to be bearers of this good news to the ends of the earth. You don't belong to me. I belong to you. Take me where you will. Help me cross whatever barrier you want me to cross, and help me how to reach out in love. Lord, for each one of us here, speak to us in this moment and in this day that we know where you are calling us to go and to share love. And Lord, where we're afraid or hesitant, Lord, we just ask that you just drive that lie out of us. Perfect love. We are loved. We love. And we can love because of you in us. Even now, put that face on our hearts of who you need us to love. In Jesus' name. Amen. One more song.
Like a rush.
Those of you in the house, I would ask that you stay after the benediction a moment. And for all of us, hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. And now the Lord says, He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and to gather Israel to himself. For I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength. He says, It is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and to bring back those of Israel I have kept. I also will make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. I'm a Gentile on the receiving end of that. Thank you, Lord. Make us that servant of yours to the ends of the earth, to the neighbor, to our family, to our friend. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.